Yes. Thanks for the thumbs up. Feels good. Feels strangely affirmed. Okay. Let's just be quiet for a moment and close your eyes. Oh, great God, you see all things, you know all things. You never hide your eyes from those who suffer. You don't lie to yourself about people's motives. You never run away from the pain you see. You never rationalize, you never construct elaborate mental models to explain away human depravity. You display great strength in your fortitude to look upon the earth that you have made with sobriety, and with vision. And so tonight, Lord, I just pray that you would give us a glimpse again of you, but also of the world we find it hard to see, to really look at, and give us courage. Always give us courage, Lord, because when I know that when I hold your hand and walk with you toward the truth, it's always scary. But I know that's where you're taking me. I know that's where you want to take us. And so we will go. We want to go with you a little deeper. And I love you for that, Lord. I love you for your desire to show us what's real. And I welcome you, Lord, your presence in Jesus' name. Amen. So much of what, because liberation theology wants to prioritize the experience of the poor, not just their suffering, but their whole experience, it's impossible then for a liberation theologian who is willing to start with the experience and willing to start with the experience of the masses, of the popular, for them not to have to face the blunt reality of economic poverty, of material poverty. Because for the majority of the world's poor, material poverty is their daily struggle. Why don't I have more than I have? Where will I get more than I have? It's hard for us to understand what it would be like to really never feel a sense of sufficiency, ever. I mean, there's just so many things in my life where I feel that it's sorted. Now, I'm not saying that there's not things where I always feel like there's not enough, but there's so many. I just think of, do you remember when, some of you might still be there, do you remember when you couldn't afford to fill up your gas tank? Does anyone remember that experience in life? And you just had what you had. Like, if you had $5, that's what you put in your gas tank, because, yep. And then however far $5 was going to take you on your gas tank, that's how far, that's where you were going that week, was $5 worth of gas.
Or a bicycle.
Or a bicycle, yeah. Well, for me, I mean, now I'm at a point in my life where I just fill up my car. I never don't fill up my gas tank. And I just have that experience now of enough. And it's hard, I think it's hard for us to wrap our minds around what it would be like that every single thing in your life that is a material reality, it's never enough. You never have enough. Not even for tomorrow. And so that material reality is, because it is central to the experience of the poor, it must then become central to the theology that we do in their name. The way that we try to understand Scripture and the person of God, we have to look at economics. In other words, what's behind the question of material poverty is the question, why? Why is it like this? Why don't we have more? Why can't we find work? Why do we have so little and they have so much? Why? So we have to venture into that territory. And I feel like this is an important enough analysis that it sort of has to have its own class. I think some of you probably have some sort of basic understanding of economics. You might have taken macroeconomics or something like that in college, or you took a semester of economics in high school. Do they still do that? It's been a while since I was in high school. Do you still just take the one semester of economics in high school? Did you pay attention? Because I didn't pay attention in high school to anything. But our sort of unsophisticated, rudimentary analysis of economics really gets us in trouble, because it's another area where we just simply cannot do theology about economics, because we don't know anything about economics. It's just an area where we just don't think it has anything to do with God or has anything to do with anything important. I mean, unless we're in finance or business or something like that, it's just not something we think about. And even then, we tend to think of it in terms of microeconomics, not macro issues. I know I wasn't paying attention in college. I didn't feel like it was a spiritual issue. And it so is. In fact, it's become for me one of the great kind of conundrums of my faith, is to try to understand, what do I want to be true economically? What is economic justice? What does it mean? What does it look like? Because I mean, as a prophetic person, it's easier for me to tell you what isn't right, or to say, I know that's not right. But to try to come up with some sort of solution is very challenging. Very challenging. And yet, Scripture has something to say about economics, quite a bit actually to say about economics, and so it's worth considering, and it has to be considered very central to the work of liberation theology. So poverty is more than economics. I want to say that, because as we venture into this kind of world of economics, I don't want you to get confused again to think I'm saying poverty is just materially derived. It's not, strictly speaking, only material, but it's not less than material. So I could say it that way. Poverty is more than economics, but it's not less than economics. You can't leave economics out of it. So the dynamics of economic systems and economic realities then are at the struggle of the poor in their struggle to be human, what it means to be human. Material wealth cannot save. And this is actually a really important statement. So if you're writing this down, this is probably one of the more important things I'll say tonight. Material wealth cannot save, it cannot satisfy, but it can cripple and it can debase. So in other words, if I get material wealth, that doesn't save me, that cannot satisfy my soul. But if I don't get material, it can and will cripple. The lack of material wealth can cripple and debase human beings. So on the one hand, we have to acknowledge that wealth is not the answer. And wealth won't save people. There's no soteriological significance to economics. It's not like, if you can get these poor people enough money, then they'll find God or something like that. That's not what we're saying. But the lack of material goods can definitely be an obstacle to people experiencing their full humanity. God forbid you're ever sort of on the street or living in a gutter or trying to eat garbage. it's very difficult for you to understand the imago Dei, the image of God in you, when you're sorting through the garbage for food. When you're that poor, or really any kind of experience of poverty, actually strips you down and debases you and cripples your ability to fully understand your humanity. So it is an obstacle, but it's not the answer. It doesn't save. And we know that because people with great amounts of wealth are not great, necessarily great people or character people. So it's not like what we really want is for all poor people to become rich people, because there's very much riches or richness, whatever that means, great wealth given to a human being is also crippling and debilitating spiritually. So what are we really looking for? What is it God wants for human beings, you know? The word, the most important word in regard to economics in the Bible is the word equality. Equality. This is what it appears God is interested in. Parity, balance, equality, justice. That you would have just enough to meet the needs that you have, but not so much that you stop needing and depending on God. This is the desire for every human being, and it's something I think God wants. I think of that bit in 2 Corinthians 8, which really, I mean, we can and we will tonight walk through kind of some different phases of the scriptures and what they have to say about economic justice, but Paul says it perfectly in 2 Corinthians 8 when he says, our desire, because he's trying to take up an offering from the Corinthians who are wealthy for the Jerusalem church who is poor. Which, by the way, is a really interesting dynamic, because if you remember in Acts 2 and Acts 4, there's this description of the first church as being, they shared everything. Remember that? They had everything in common, it said. And because they shared, and it said, whenever there was someone in need, do you remember what it said they did? They would sell a piece of property. Which, of course, in the ancient world, property was, that's your security. That's your sort of like cashing in a 401k or something like that. So whenever there was a need, somebody would just sell a piece of property, cash in that 401k. Fast forward 10 years, 20 years, guess what? The Jerusalem church is totally poor. They're out of money. Nobody's selling property anymore because they already sold all their property. And now Paul is actually having to ask Gentile believers, can you send some money to Jerusalem? Because they're broke. Totally broke. So that picture, that snapshot we have in Acts 2 and Acts 4 of this communal kind of sharing of wealth, you could look at that and sort of ask the question, then why in less than a generation are they all poor? And there are other issues going on. Jerusalem drew in more poor people. Jews would have been a sort of second class community anyway. So there's a lot of things working against them. But it's interesting that Paul has to make this appeal to a Gentile church to say, don't forget your brothers in Jerusalem. And for Paul, the word koinonia, which gets translated community, it also could be translated fellowship. He actually will interchange the word fellowship or community with giving. So to him, he's like, why don't you show koinonia? I want you to show fellowship to the church in Jerusalem and give money. Because we're a family, and you have more and they have less. And this is what he says in 2 Corinthians 8. This is perfectly sums up, I think, the hope of the scriptures. Our desire is not that you would be hard-pressed, but that in your plenty, you would give out of your extra, and you would make up for what's lacking in them. So that one day, if you're lacking, their plenty would make up for you. What is it that he wants from them? Not that they would become poor. So he's not saying, man, I want you guys to just sell all your property and you guys become a problem, so now I'm over at Ephesus trying to raise money for Corinth. He's saying, and then he says, he actually uses the word, our desire is that there would be equality. Our desire is that there would be equality. Now, you might think, well, that's a very ordinary word. It's a very pedestrian word, particularly for the American consciousness. But listen, in a Greco-Roman world, that in Palestine at this time, that is a crazy sentiment. It's just very unheard of to say, actually, what we want is everyone to have the same, that there would be equality of income. It's just unheard of. But that was the apostles' desire, that there would be economic equality. And I think that his desire, Paul's desire, mirrors God's desire. And before I make that argument, I just want to deal for a second with this false dichotomy which hangs over us as we enter into this discussion. Because we've been given, the Western mind loves dualities. We love binary choices, even if they're false. We love them. We take them, you know. Republican, Democrat, this is pertinent now. Do you ever feel that way when someone says, are you Republican or are you Democrat? What do you say? Do you have an answer as a Christian? Because the truth is, I think the correct answer, if you're interested for me, the correct answer is, I am neither. That is the correct answer. I am neither. In fact, a better answer, so I'm helping you out here, for your friends at the water cooler, is a Republican or Democrat. You say, I am neither, and I reject the premise itself that you're proposing, that human beings are either Democrats or Republicans. I reject that premise, because what you're saying is people are either this or they are that. And do you know anyone? Well, I'm sure there are some people who are fully one or fully the other, or this. But that, to me, that's more cultish. That's not, if you're fully Republican or fully Democrat and you just, the party line is what you believe, then that isn't actually about a thinking human being. That's just you're part of the cult of that political party. And nothing sort of demonstrates that more than when people literally hate a nominee until they win the nomination, and then they all align behind them. So like 10 minutes ago, you were like, this guy's the devil. Case in point in the current Republican situation. Everyone hated him. And now it's like, what a great Republican he is. And he's, all our hopes and dreams are hanging on him. And he's going to unite the world. And he's a Christian now and whatever else we need him to be to believe. The truth is, I just don't know a lot of serious people who don't hold a mixture of views. I mean, even people that maybe sort of lean towards one kind of stream and lean toward the other, you probably will find some way in which they're different. Like, I miss the Southern Democrat. There used to be a thing where there was a Southern Democrat, so sort of morally conservative, would have been against abortion, but economically progressive. It's like, where do those people go? They're all gone. They're all dead. They've all been pushed into this sort of like, you have to be hardcore this and believe this whole thing and hardcore that. The point is, the dichotomy is false. The duality is false. It's not real. It's not real how human beings really are. And the presenting of the choice is false and wrong in itself. So the question is false. And I think we must refuse to answer it. And there are other questions like that too. Even to refuse to accept the premise of the question. So why did I bring that up? Because I think there's a similar false dichotomy which is offered to us in economics. And that is capitalism and socialism. That we're led to believe that there are basically only two working economic theories. And you sort of have to pick one. You're forced to choose one or the other. And then, of course, if you're a Christian, then you're forced to justify your choice with the Bible. You're supposed to find a way to justify your choice with the Bible. Capitalism or socialism. Socialism would be sort of the ideological term behind communism. Communism is really more of a political thing. Socialism is is the economic system that propels, just as capitalism is the economic system that propels democratic republic, which is what we have. Anyway, capitalism argues, and I know you know this, so I'm just going to breeze over this quickly, but capitalism argues for the justice of markets. They believe that markets sort things out. So when people work hard, they can gain greater market share and greater wealth. So in other words, the market is unbiased, the market is objective. Just work hard, find a thing that's needed, buy, sell, produce, and you will, if you work really hard at that, you'll corner a piece of that market and you'll get a piece of that wealth. And if you work really hard, you can get even more. And so the people who gain more wealth because they've maximized their market and they deserve it. It's a merit system. The idea is that those who work harder will earn more money, and those who don't want to work as hard will earn less money. And so it evens itself out. It's like, and in a sense, there's justice in that. The justice is, if you don't want to work as hard, you get less money. But if you're okay with having less money, that's your choice. You don't have to work as hard. It's a trade-off. But if you want to work really hard, or really, really hard, well, then you're going to get more wealth. And so what it means is, at the end of the day, the guy with a ton of wealth and the guy with a little bit of wealth, well, that's what they deserved, you see. They worked within the free market capital system. It was free. In fact, freedom is a big part of capitalism, the idea that you're free. You're free to not work if you don't want. You can get $0, and you're free to work a little, get 10. You're free to work a lot and get 1,000. It's up to you. The system is fair because markets are unbiased, and they respond only to hard work and initiative. That's a belief in that system. On the other hand, socialism argues for the justice of distribution. So this is a different. You have to see this distinction here between the market itself being sort of unbiased and creating a just system on its own, versus socialism, which says no, somebody needs to have power over distribution. That everyone, regardless of the job they do, should be given their fair share of the total wealth. Wealth should be distributed not based on so-called merit, but based on the fairness and human equality. And just what we could say effort put in. So the guy who's sort of cleaning the building and the guy who's managing the building and the guy who's the president of the company, in a sense, all put in a day's work, the company makes a certain amount of money, shouldn't they all get paid something similar? Because they all did their part, whatever their part was, whatever they were capable of doing, they did their part and they should get their share, a fair share, equal distribution. And you could argue, and socialists would argue, that the janitor's job is just as important in the flow of human society as the manager or as the president. And so everyone should get something equal to the other, and if there's extra, the extra should be shared equally between everyone. Now, because a socialist would say, because human beings are greedy, they're not going to do that without being forced to. So you do have, typically, what happens when people think about socialism is they also think about fascism right next to it. They assume that there's going to have to be some sort of repressive government that puts that in place. So what people are really scared of, I'm trying to be favorable here. What a capitalist is scared of in a socialist economy is over-governance. Government sort of forcing people. And it feels like the opposite of freedom. While it sounds good morally, yeah, everyone gets their fair share because everyone deserves to be paid similar. We're not really, capitalists won't be comfortable with the loss of freedom that they perceive that comes from giving someone the power to distribute money or distribute wealth. So the socialist says of the capitalist system, listen, it isn't fair, it isn't just. You think that markets will be unbiased, but markets are not unbiased. And so much of what makes capitalism work is capital. In other words, you have to start with a bunch of money. And if you start with a bunch of money, you have a leg up on the other guy. So you're already, if you start off rich, you already have an advantage to the guy that starts off poor. It's not like everybody starts with a fair shake. It's not true at all. And the capitalists have a good point towards socialism. Like, show me socialism at work somewhere besides a tiny little commune or something, where it's not repressive government attached to it. where you don't have people's freedoms taken away. And then abuse happens when the government is the one giving out the money, and some people get a little more, even though they're claiming that they don't. Capitalism would say no one has to be poor because they can always work harder. And capitalism typically wants to blame the person, the poor person, for their situation. Socialism wants to say no one should be poor because hoarding wealth should be a crime. No one should be poor because you can't keep too much. It needs to be given away. And if you keep too much, you're in trouble. And these, unfortunately, are our choices. These are our choices that we've been given. And I think anyone who's committed to the Bible as their authority has to realize this is a rigged game. Both the choices are not correct. The premise itself is incorrect. The binary dualism itself is incorrect. And by the way, I mean, the more I say, I mean, aside from sort of intelligentsia, real life people, if you say, the people I know that sort of hold on to a socialist position think capitalist people are the devil. And capitalist types think socialist people are the devil, which proves to me no one's thinking clearly. No one's thinking clearly. When we create those kind of silos, we need a third way. We particularly need a third way. So let's consider the Bible for a minute. Before I do that, I want to ask this question. What is law? What is law? Particularly when it relates to the Bible. Because the first five books of the Bible for the nation of Israel, for the Jewish people, was called, they referred to it as the law. They called it the law. And the law was the precious gift that God had given to the human race. This treasure that Hebrews were meant to steward. You know, David said, "Your law, I delight in your law. I meditate on it. It's like a light to my path. I write its precepts upon my heart." What is the law? Why? And then, you know, fast forward to the Pharisees and Jesus talking about the law. It's like, what was wrong with David? Because why would you like the law that much? What was it about the law that he liked so much? We have to ask the question, what is law? Because I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about the law. I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about the Hebrew law given by God from that mountain. What is law and why was it so precious to them? Law is an attempt to codify ethics. So law is not actually the thing. What's behind law is ethics. Ethics is how we relate to each other, what our expectations are in our relationships to each other, what is good, right, and moral interaction with other human beings. That's the question of ethics, social expectations, social righteousness. And what law does is law attempts to put into words, put into to function ethics. So you should not kill, you shall not kill, because there's an ethic of preserving life. Do you understand? So the law is not the thing, it's the ethics behind the thing. And if you could go, that's the deeper held belief about how humans ought to behave towards each other. And then when we think about the law of God, this series of commandments, prohibitions that God gives his people as this kind of first gesture of a revelation of himself to them. He's trying to show them who he is. And he does that by giving them law. And really, actually, what he's doing is he's opening up a system of ethics to them. It's not just like we need to do this and go blank mentally and not think about why. We're supposed to meditate on the law of the Lord every day. That was their expectation. The law was meant to be put on their door frames so that every time they walked in and out of their house, they thought on the law of God. Not because I need to memorize the 613 commandments of the Torah, but because I need to wonder why those commandments were given to us. What does it say about God? Why should we keep the Sabbath holy? Why? What does it mean? What's important in human relationships? It's a question of ethics. And deeper than that, it's a question of the revelation of God, of himself, of his own heart. This is why the law, in a very real sense, was for the pre-Jesus experience of the people of God. It was what they had to understand the heart of God. In other words, laws are not the thing. The heart of God, the way of God, is the thing. And I think that's the right word, the way of God. There is a way that God has. And we want to walk in it, know it, live it. In fact, for the Jew, the law was synonymous with Torah. Torah, saying the law, is synonymous. And Torah, in Hebrew, means the way. Torah means the way. It is our way. It is his way. God's way. So, I'm gonna talk just really briefly about a couple of Levitical laws, but I don't want you to sort of check out because you think, well, that's Old Testament law. That doesn't apply to us anymore. And in one sense, it doesn't because of the fulfillment of Jesus, which we'll talk about in a second. But it still reveals the ethics of God and the heart of God behind him. And that's what we have to be considering as we think about economics. Because God did deliver within the law, within Torah, he delivered economic laws. Laws that govern the way that people dealt with money and wealth and each other. And to pretend like they don't exist anymore because we're Christian and we only read the New Testament is a mistake. And it's irresponsible. We can say it this way. Jesus did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. Therefore, what is the law doing? It is leading us partway there and needs fulfillment. It is not enough. It cannot save. Or as the way the Apostle Paul put it, he said that the law is a school teacher or schoolmaster that takes you by the hand to a certain point in your age and development, and then Jesus has to take you on to its completion. So Jesus being the fulfillment of the law does not negate what the law teaches about ethics and about the heart of God. So let's just consider for a second something like Leviticus 25. This is, we're given in Leviticus 25 what's called the law of Jubilee. And I know you know this, but well, let's back up for a second. We have Sabbath law. So much of what the rhythm of life for a ancient Jew would have been this idea of Sabbath. 6 days you work, and on the seventh day you rest. And that would have been expanded into the life of the community. And in an agrarian society, so you have land, and land produces wealth because land creates crops and livestock, and that's how you raise food. That's your capital. And that's how you can get extra, either to share or keep or sell. Land is the wealth producing. Land is means of production. Land is the factory of the ancient world. And so the way that God designed it was that these 12 tribes of Israel were given, in that land of Cana, they were given pieces of land. They were actually allotted portions of land. Every single tribe, every single family was given some land. And of course this land was all rich and farmable and healthy land. That's what they were given. And so within the framework and the rhythm of Sabbath, 6 days you work the land, and the seventh day you rest. And then 6 years you work the land, and the seventh year you rest the land. So you actually don't take in harvest on the seventh year of your land. Which, by the way, I don't know anything about farming or agriculture or anything, but I understand that that's good for the land. I understand that's good for the soil. To actually rest the soil, actually rest the land, to not every single year give it no break. And so that's built in as well. But what happens with those Sabbath laws is that there were certain things that you couldn't do on the Sabbath day, and certain things you were supposed to do on Sabbath day, and certain things you were supposed to do on Sabbath year. One of the things that you were supposed to do, for example, so this is a connection again between law, I mean, we're really talking about agricultural practice, and ethics. So one of the things you were supposed to do every 7 years, think about the significance of this, every 7 years, if you had Hebrew slaves, they were to be released. So nobody could ever be a slave for more than 6 years. This is how God builds it in. Now, it's important too to say the word slave, the experience of being a slave, I don't know what the equivalent would be. It's nothing like American slavery. Like you're less, you're debased. Because think of that, even within 6 years, you just go right back to being one of us. The best example I can think of in our modern kind of mind for what it would have been like to be a slave is a minimum wage worker. A person that works for minimum wage. In other words, you're so broke and you have nothing that you have to join someone's household and work their land just for room and board. They didn't. You weren't allowed to be beaten. You weren't. There was no. You're less than us. It was just the lowest possible job. Can you understand? The lowest paying job that there was. When you have no wealth and you have no title and you have no place, the last thing you can do is just say, "I'll just become a servant." But if you're Hebrew, the law commands, requires that every seventh year, you're free. You're released. And of course, slaves could have themselves saved a little, built a little wealth, made friends with their owners, worked some deals on the side. They could have built their own kind of business. They weren't restricted in the same way we think about slaves because they were equal. They were equals in dignity. They just had no money, and they were reduced to the lowest possible job, the lowest paying job. They would have been kind of the low totem pole workers. But even that, every 7 years, the law commanded they were supposed to be released. Released. Yeah, Chris. Yes. So debts are forgiven. Slaves are released. There's all these sort of ethical implications of a Sabbath year. And then every seventh year. So now you're really getting, I don't know, numerology, you know, it's like important. So 6 years and then seventh year you rest. Well, what about the seventh time you do that? And so in Leviticus 25, it's the law outlines this explosive celebration of the seventh year. And in that time, not only are slaves released, not only are all debts forgiven, not only is everything returned to equal state, equilibrium, but all land goes back to its original owners. So again, remember, land is means of production. Land is everything in the economy, in the agrarian economy. Land is everything. And he's saying every 50 years, I want you to think about this for a second. What are the implications of saying every 50 years, everything goes back to its starting point? So all the families were given a plot of land, but then in the course of 50 years, people could take other land or buy bits of land, or somebody could make mistakes and lose part of their land or lose their wealth or lose their livestock, and other people could gain more, and people could change the boundary lines of their means of production. But in the 50th year, we all go back again. Just for a second, I'm gonna pause here. Just talk to me about the implications of that. What could that have meant for that community or that society? Say again. That's right, because even if you're killing it for 40 years, amassing wealth, you just go back to zero again. So you're right, we would never have a Rockefeller or a Bill Gates or something, because you can't have multi-generations of wealth accumulation, right? You'd only have, I mean, in theory, you would only have 40 some years to get as much wealth as you possibly could before it goes back to zero. Yeah. That's a really interesting and really important point. They would have seen themselves more as stewards because the land, those boundary lines are set from generation to generation. They're going to reset. So even if I could gain some of your land, it's temporary. And those the sense that this land belongs to someone else is permanent. That feels more permanent. I think you're right. And actually, I think that's even outlined in the law, that if you did take over someone else's land, you didn't really get title to the land, you just got the fruit of the land. So in other words, you got to keep the crops. But it's not like you said, I am now an owner of this other part of the land. You could gain economic advantage by saying, the next 6 years of this crop belong to me. But the land itself, you're right, is more static. What else? Yeah. There wouldn't be chronic poverty, because even if you had a really bad run, if you could hang in there, your family could hang in there. In theory, you could get back to zero again. You could start over again, and that was part of the expectation of law, that there shall be no poor among you. That's a command in the law. You shall have no poor among you. It was not acceptable to God for His people to have the poor. And so most of the time when you see allowances made for the very poor in the Bible, in the Old Testament, they're talking about the stranger. They're talking about the visitor, the person passing through, because the expectation was, if this person's a Hebrew, they should never go without food or shelter or clothing. Their family. Like, did it work? Is that what you're asking?
I mean, if you go back to where it started, where did it start? Like, how was everyone from the starting point?
The starting point would have been like entering the promised land, taking Cana. This
everybody
is
kind of did equal.
Yes, everyone divided up the land. I guess the closest thing in our history would be like homesteading, you know, where pioneers went west. I mean, my great-great-grandfather supposedly took a stake with a flag and stuck it in Zephyr Hills. And that was his land. Because he just said, I'll take this area. And there was no one there but mosquitoes and alligators. And people said, you can have it. But that's how it worked. Like, there's no one here. There's abundance. I'll take this section, you take that section. That's how it would have started. That entry into Cana, into this promised land flowing with milk and honey. This kind of rich, healthy land.
Does it rewrite like the fabric of relationships in all of society? Like, it just seems like nothing can take hold. None of this negative, as you're saying, abject poverty over generations, or the Rockefellers, the massing of wealth. But there's always hope for a reset. There's always hope to start over, to fix mistakes. Nothing's permanent. And then our relationships can never be affected by that.
Well, they can be affected, but not for long. And I think you're right. I think it changes the stakes. So what I find really interesting about this Jubilee law is that it does allow, I mean, for lack of a better word, to use, I mean, let me ask you this. Is this law more socialist or capitalist?
What's the difference?
So, who thinks it's more socialist? Someone be brave. Okay, tell me why. Talk to me about that. Tell me why you see socialism in it.
Well, in the 49th year, you know, just think of like people aren't going to be loaning you a lot of money or whatever.
True, yeah.
Even in the 60th year.
What purpose? You really want to be borrowing a lot of money in the 49th year, you know what I mean?
So it seems like in the gaps, there's capitalism at work, but you always have that under socialism is going to affect your decisions.
It's going to put it back to equality or something.
Yeah.
Well,
I mean, socialism is based on the common good.
Yes.
The common wealth that we share.
Yes.
And capitalism is there's an opportunity, you have to earn it.
Yes.
So it's up to you, the individual, to be motivated and go do it.
Yeah. So that drive for, like, we're thinking of what's best for everyone, that feels more socialist. All right, who thinks capitalism is in there? Give me an argument for that. Now you're just scared. Sure, yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yes, I think that's right. So you're talking about like 6 years, 49 years, there's these pockets where it's like buy and sell, and if you can get up over on the other guy and you work a little harder and you work more of your land, or somebody else is being lazy and they don't work their land and you say, well, let me work your land, then you can collect more crops and you can grow more livestock and you can have more wealth, right? That's possible. So within this framework, there is the possibility of free markets. There's some free market going on here, but it's checked by this greater thing. So again, it is a third way because it kind of has a little bit of both in it. There is some freedom to work hard and earn more, and there will be discrepancies. But those discrepancies are bound, they're not limitless, right? They can never get out of hand because every 50 years we start over. So there's no chance of extreme disparity of wealth. But there is a chance for small disparities of wealth, and that might even, you could even argue, is encouraged. You can, if you want to work a little harder and you want to work more of your land, then you get more. And this is actually one of the critiques of communism, is people didn't work hard. Because why? I'm gonna get the same salary whether I kill myself today at work or if I just work for 2 hours and look at the sky most of the time, I'm still gonna get the same salary. And I'm gonna get the same apartment and the same car and the same life, so why work hard? And so within this framework, there's the parameters, the boundaries, that you cannot have runaway greed, you cannot have runaway wealth discrepancy, disparity of wealth, but there is some room for ingenuity, and some room for industry, and some sort of reward within that smaller system for that. Yeah?
I want to clarify one thing. If we go back to zero, it doesn't mean that everybody's pile of donuts is distributed equally. This type of system, wealth isn't a finite number. When you do an economic system well, wealth actually increases. There's more stuff to get around. So somebody gets to the end of the 50th year, if he's done well, he doesn't go back to whatever he was 50 years ago. He keeps a part of that, what he created, what was brought up.
But also his...
Everybody has a chance to grow in that 50 years.
But everyone would have shared in that abundance or that excess.
It's more to split up.
Yes, it's more to split up.
Overall, everybody gets better.
You're right. No, that's a good point. It's not back to zero. It's just back to equality.
Yes,
back to equal pieces. Yeah.
Is the land goes back, or like if you've amassed any type of wealth or built it?
The land would have been returned to its original family ownership. I suppose so.
Yeah, that's
but the land was the... Like,
the land was the means of production.
Yeah.
So the land is the factory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. And... Why fight and die for something that you're going to give back in 12 years or something? Yes, agreed. The desire to amass within those boundaries has got to be somewhat curtailed. You're not as ambitious, maybe. Yeah, JP.
Is that anything that's water or not?
Well, there's a whole series of Levitical laws related to the foreigner, and they're meant to be treated with a certain kind of honor and respect, even as if they were God himself, a representative of God. That's an entirely different revelation about the ethics of God, you know, that the stranger in one real sense is even more sacred than our own people. Yeah.
So do people actually do this, and for how long?
Yeah, there's no evidence that it was ever done. It doesn't mean that it wasn't. It's just we don't have any record of whether they ever actually did it. And you think there might have been, because this would have been interesting. So there's no evidence that they ever actually practiced this principle. So, but for me, that only makes the point that it is otherworldly, which just makes it more important, in my view, that it reveals something that human beings really need and we struggle to implement. Because it reveals something that's part of the fabric of God, but which our own sin nature has somehow corrupted and made it very, very hard for us to do this. So again, let's go back to this idea of like, no one will be the ultra rich. It's not possible to create multi-generational wealth. This is really important. Because now what we're talking about is you can get ahead in your lifetime, but only so far, and you cannot pass that on to your children. So now what you've done, I mean, it's really genius. What you've actually done is you've said nobody gets a free ticket in the next generation. There's nobody born with a silver spoon. It's curtailed by generations, by one human lifetime. One human lifetime. You personally can sort of get ahead a little bit, but you don't get to give that to your children. And then your children are sort of like, I was born rich, and I'm going to build on that riches, more riches. I'm going to have an advantage over everyone else because we can, over generations, keep amassing more and more wealth and keep that disparity between rich and poor growing and growing and growing and growing. And it's interesting, we'll talk about this more in a minute, but we have this perception that we're winning the battle on poverty. And in some very real senses, there are statistics that bear that out. For instance, when I first started teaching on this subject in the early 90s, we used to say that every day 38,000 children die of starvation and preventable causes. Today, that number is 22,000. So that's progress. We're talking about severe poverty and people, like children dying from starvation and preventable causes. So the most severe forms of poverty, we are making progress in dealing with those things. So I think that's good news. However, in my lifetime, global wealth has grown 5 times. So it's 5 times larger than when I was born now, global wealth, total global wealth. And the disparity between rich and poor has quadrupled. So in other words, the difference between the poor and the rich is not getting smaller, it's getting bigger. So we are creating way more wealth in this world and just keeping more of it to rich people. So is severe poverty, are we dealing with that? Yes, a little bit of that money is trickling down, a little bit of aid, a little bit of help to deal with the most reprehensible kind of expressions of poverty. But the actual hard facts of wealth and poverty is that the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. We don't have a moral leg to stand on because we've created 5 times as much wealth and we've given almost none of it to the very poor. So the rich keep getting way, way richer, and the poor just get a little bit more. They get the crumbs from the table. And have those crumbs helped? Yes. Have they staved off starvation for some people? Yes. But because global wealth has grown so tremendously, it makes us even more culpable for their more than ever. We have way more than we need. We always have. And now we have even more than we need. And we're still not really facing and dealing with the problem. I keep thinking about law, and I think it's important because we're considering the law, what it reveals about God. And in the law, we find like this need for Jesus, the hunger for Jesus. The law, I think, leads us to Jesus. And in Jesus, like I said before, we find the fulfillment of the law, the resolution of the law, what the law leads us to, the questions the law leads us to ask. The ethics that the law uncovers finds its resolution and its fulfillment in Jesus. He is the embodiment of the ethics of the law. He is all of that come in human form. He is the image of the invisible God. You know, John said, no one has ever seen God, but we have seen his Son, and he's come to us full of grace and truth. This is why in Luke 4, which we've already talked about, when Jesus steps into ministry, he touches the law of Jubilee. He wants to refer to it. He wants to say, my coming, my entry into this world, and my entry into human society is the coming of Jubilee. He wants them to remember that law and the prophet's cry for its fulfillment. And he wants to say, I am that fulfillment. It's time to return the land to the people. That's what Luke 4 is saying. He's making an economic statement. He's making an economic comment to his time. And to the purpose of Messiah. So it's interesting to me that the law, you know, Jesus is the fulfillment of this law, but within the law doesn't prohibit land acquisition or its loss. There is freedom, there is market economy at work, but it's not unchecked. It can only go so far. It can only go one generation. What that means is that people can work a little bit harder. They can earn more than someone else. Merit-based pay or wealth acquisition does seem to have some basis in Scripture, but you can't inherit it. And I think that's, to me, I just think that's totally radical. You can't inherit it. You can work for it. You can work a little harder. And if you work harder, you can be rewarded for that extra hard work. But you cannot inherit it off of somebody else's hard work, named your mom or your dad. I think that's powerful. I mean, as a parent, I just think it's really smart. It's really good. You want people to feel like, yeah, if I work hard, if I try, if I do something with my whole heart or with passion, there's the chance for there to be greater fruit. But I have to do it. I can't draft off somebody else's hard work. I can't cheat off of someone else. This does away with rich privilege. You know, rich people love to pass on their wealth to their children, but this is not allowed in Scripture. I think it's so fascinating. I had the chance to spend some time with some very, very wealthy people. And I don't know how, but I sort of ended up in this room where they were talking about investing. And when I say investing, I don't mean, oh, I'm going to play the stock market, or I have a mutual fund or something. I'm talking about like massive wealth investment, hundreds of millions of dollars. And everyone's just kind of talking because they're like, yeah, what do you do? And this is what I do. And I was just like, what am I doing here? And I think I have like $300 in my savings account. That's the extent of my wealth, my barn. But I thought it was really fascinating. And they started talking about their kids. And the one guy who's, I mean, he was really like managing a lot of money, a lot of wealth. And everybody in the room sort of, I think, deferred to him. And even though to me they were all just in a different category completely, this guy to them was even in a different category. So they were sort of in awe of him. And they started talking about what they did with their kids. And a lot of them have family foundations and things like that where they do want to give away large amounts of their money, and so they put that money in a foundation and they have to talk about how they give the money away, and they usually do it as a family, which is interesting. You know, you sort of get the whole family together and say, this year we got $100 million to give away, you know, here are the requests and who do we want to support and why, and people usually have their own little, different family members might have different projects they're particularly interested in, but they have to sort of field requests and talk about what their family philosophy is for giving. It's really interesting. And imagine what it would be like to be a child and you're 12 and it's time for you to start coming to the family foundation meetings. And you're now part of a process of writing millions of dollars in checks and sending them, giving away, whatever. And so the one guy was like, what I do is when my kids turn 10, imagine this for a second, when my kids turn 10, I give them $10,000 to play the stock market. It's just so they can experience investing and watching their money fail or succeed. And so this is a $10,000 game. It's a game, but they want it to be real, you know. So it's like, I'm like, can we just pretend? Can we just be like, you pick a stock and let's put $100,000 on that stock? You know, like, it's not real. We just, they would never even know. We could just say we did it, and they would never know. But no, that has to be real money because they want them to feel what it's like to have kind of used money. And it dawns on me that they're training these kids to be wealthy. They're training them how to be wealthy. I think it's probably, I guess in that scenario, it's probably the right thing to do. You don't want them to just inherit a bunch of money. One day they turn 21 and God forbid you get cancer or something, and then they end up with, you know, $100 million estate, and then they're just immature and they waste it and they drive the business in the ground or something. It's like you want to teach them. They want these kids to start to learn how to handle large amounts of money, how to deal with sort of making decisions about investments and so on. And then it occurs to me, like, if we really took this kind of the ethics of the law, that would never happen. You know, every kid goes back to zero, or they got to start their own, on their own. They don't get an advantage over another kid. They might grow up in a good house or get a good education because their parents could give them that, but when they start their life, they know they have to start from nothing or from whatever the equal starting point would be. We just don't have that ethic at work. We don't see it anywhere. I know there are people that give away money, give away large amounts of money. And actually, what the best we can hope for in our kind of like cash-rich country is that wealthy people would be generous people. That's what we're always sort of asking for. That's the best we can hope for. And yet that even in itself is not a biblical standard. It's not that the rich would be generous. It's that the rich would be fair. And actually that there wouldn't be rich because rich people wouldn't take more than they needed. But that there would be equality. I mean, the question that the Bible wants to ask, I think, is the question, is there enough? Is there enough for everyone? It's simplistic, but it's as if God is saying, I will give enough food for the world. You know, there's enough grain produced in the world every day to feed every person twice. We manufacture enough food product for every human being in the world, and then some. But people still go hungry. It's not that God has not provided enough for the world. He has. and then some. But you know, it takes something like 6 pounds of grain fed to cattle to produce 1 pound of beef. So why do we overproduce grain? We overproduce grain because we need to feed our livestock, because, for example, we have this tremendous craving for meat. So Americans want to eat so much meat that we will feed a cow 6 pounds of grain, which could have, in theory, been shared in the world, to produce 1 pound of beef, which we will eat, 4 quarter pounders. 6 pounds of grain spent to produce 1 pound. I think chicken is 3 to 1, something like that. 3 pounds of grain to create 1 pound of chicken. It's interesting, if you go to other parts of the world, you'll see that when they eat meat, typically, when they eat meat, there will be just a little bit of meat. You know, it's like a parsley on top or something. It's like rice, potatoes, whatever the staple is for that culture, and a little meat and sauce, you know. Meat is just a delicacy, it's a luxury, and yet how do we roll? You know, it's meat. In fact, when I was growing up, you saw like a TV dinner or something like that. Did anybody ever eat a TV dinner? I mean, a TV dinner is sort of the expression of what we think like an American meal is supposed to look like, right? Hungry man or something. And it's little trays, little bits, little compartments in a tray. Well, which was the biggest compartment? Always the meat was the biggest compartment, right? The chicken or the Salisbury steak or whatever. And that's the big one. And then you have like a little bit of potatoes, a little bit of corn, a brownie. In fact, the brownie is as big as the vegetables or whatever. You want the little brownie. You know the brownie was good, though. That was good. So that represents how we eat. It represents what we think is a balanced meal or a correct meal. Meat and potatoes. Meat and potatoes. What, meat comes first, then potatoes, I guess. There's plenty. In other words, the world actually produces. So the world God gave us, produces enough clean water and enough foodstuffs to satisfy every human being. So what's the problem? The problem is that some of us who control the means of production don't like to share with the rest of us. And that's an oversimplification, but it's not incorrect. It is true. And so there is culpability in the failure of distribution. It's a question of distribution. And this really important biblical word, equality, when attached to this other important biblical word, distribution, we now see the problem. The problem is not that there isn't enough. There is enough. The problem is not that equality is not something that's possible. It is possible. In fact, there's abundance. The problem is distribution. The people that hold the means of production and hold the means of distribution do not, will not, have decided to not equally distribute it. And that's a violation of God's law. It is a violation of God's law. When Paul says to the Corinthians, you eat the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. Do you remember that strange passage where he says, you eat the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, and part of it was because of the way they treated the poor. And certain people were eating a lot, they were eating it all up. There's this feast, and people would eat it all up, and the poor would get none, or they get left out, or they would eat it all, and there would be none left over for the other people. And so actually it was the Lord's Supper, it was this love feast, and the poor were not getting any because some people were just gorging themselves in gluttony at the Lord's table. That was happening. And that's when Paul says, when you do that, you eat and drink judgment on yourself because you do not, this, he says this very strange phrase, you do not discern the body. And North Americans have no idea what he's talking about. You don't discern the body. In fact, I've had lots of people say, what does it mean? And we should examine ourselves, Brian, before communion. We're too cavalier about communion because what if we're judged or whatever? You know what's going on in that text. And what it means to discern the body is to say, look, we have relationships with each other. We are the body of Christ. And if somebody goes without, if somebody somewhere is going without, then I cannot in good conscience, if I've kept back some food or some resource from another person and I've kept extra for myself, I do not discern the body, the fellowship of the body, and I eat and drink judgment on myself. It's an economic issue. And the breach of communion is because there was a breach of relationship, economic relationship. Because those who have been entrusted with the distribution of wealth of the world are not just. Those of us that have been entrusted with the distribution of the wealth of the world, we are not just. And we do not do God's will. We do not do God's will. Listen, if tonight somehow there was a pathogen released in the air and we were all like infected with a terminal virus, let's say that happened tonight. But no fear, don't have fear, because someone gave me the antidote and I have it, the antivirus. I have the cure and I have enough for everyone, plenty actually. Enough for everyone. And so I say, well, I have to go, but it's a simple matter. It's just a little injection. We've got plenty. Everyone can come up and get some. And I just give the three of you the supply. And I say, I trust you to make sure everyone gets some. And all of a sudden, the three that have control think for a minute and feel something happen inside them. Some sort of awareness of an opportunity or an advantage that they now have because they hold this precious resource. And so they think, okay, huh, people have to come to us to get this. We decide who gets it and who doesn't. They feel that power coursing through them. And maybe there's some grudges in the room that the three have. Maybe they have some biases against certain people. And immediately those biases would become a matter of life and death. Because now those biases could mean the difference between whether or not you get any or not. Maybe I don't give you any. Because I never really liked you that much. And I didn't like the way you talked to me when I walked in the other day. And I didn't like how you always go in the main bathroom and you always make me go into the back bathroom with the stalls and the weird paper on the walls. Maybe they would become aware of an economic advantage. Maybe they'd say, okay, well, what if we just charge some money? I mean, what's it worth to people? It's a market here. We've cornered the market. In fact, we have a monopoly on this market. We could charge whatever we want. We charge $5, people would pay because they're going to die if they don't. Forget it. We could charge $5,000. And so they look at it and they see, we have an opportunity here. We want people to have it, but what's wrong? We make little money on the side as we do it. And so we say, yeah, we like $5,000. We think that's good. And so now there's a scramble. Because maybe you've got $5,000 sitting around in your bank account, so you come up, you pay it off. Maybe you're friends with them and you have a little extra advantage, so you say, look, I'll get it to you later, or just give me a freebie, and maybe they do because they really like you or because you're really close to them. And maybe a couple people skate by, but the others have to come up with the $5,000. So now you're scrambling, seeing some of you have friends you could call and loans that you can make, but maybe there's four or five of you that can't come up with the $5,000. And guess what? You die. There's not a single person in this room that would not call that a crime. Isn't that a crime? Isn't that sin? Isn't that greed? Isn't that a deadly sin? It's not just opportunism. It's not just business. It's a crime. Because the ethics of the relationships that God wants us to have with each other and with other people, the ethics require us to realize that this thing which we have been given in abundance is for everyone. It is a public trust. It belongs to everyone. And yes, some of us are given the stewardship of it. It's placed into our hands, which I think is a great honor. And if our better selves won out the day, and because we're actually friends, and many of you know each other, the three probably what they would do without thinking is just quickly load up and distribute, because of course. You know, my experience doing like poverty simulations and stuff like that with students over the years, sometimes we would put them in situations where we would create community, they bond together, and then we give them a little money, and they have to share that money in order to be able to provide for themselves. And then one of the things I used to do in the Urban Project is I would some weeks give some more and some less, or some zero. So they're so used to this sort of egalitarian thing. We all get our little bit of money, and we all put it in the pot, and we all share, and we're all one in Jesus, and we're all like unified, and this is how the church should be. And all of a sudden I throw a wrench in their thing, and somebody gets extra, and somebody gets less. And the people that are used to getting, how much did it used to be, John? Was it, how much? $15 a week, something like that. That was what I gave them. And then somebody would get like 20. And somebody else would get like 4. And the person that's getting 4 is mad. What's going on? The world is not right. And sometimes the person that I gave 20 would be like, praise God, extra $5. And they just keep it. Because, you know, I got extra. What does that have to do with the fact that you only got 4? I'm sorry. That's how the world works. But you know what usually would happen? What usually would happen is that the students would be like, we're not falling for this, Brian. Nice try. And they'd still put their stuff in the pot. And that was fine with me too, because I'd just be like, oh, okay, if you're so moral and you do that, why don't you do that in real life? So we're not falling for this. We're a family. We're a community. Sure, I have 20. I'll throw it all in there. You have 4. I'll throw it on there. It still evens out, because in the end it doesn't matter. And we won't, you know, we're better than that. Are you? Because every single day there's a discrepancy in the wages people earn and the way that wealth is distributed. There's a discrepancy. And part of what I think is being revealed in Scripture is not really that we need to be generous, more generous, and give away our money, but actually we just need to see that we are stewards of abundance. And we should take exactly the amount we need, and the rest of it should be distributed to those who have need. And if you were the ones that were given the vaccine for everyone, that's how you'd see it. If you were in a house and you were in a simulation, you wouldn't fall for it. So why? Why do we fall for it? Part of the reason why we fall for it is because we don't have fellowship with each other. Because koinonia is lost. I mean, think of what Paul's trying to do. Paul's trying to say, look, Church of Corinth, Gentiles, you don't even know these people in Jerusalem. They're a world away from you, and yet they are your family. That's what he's saying. They're your family. You ought to care for them. This is how we have to see each other. What happens in the first church, particularly in Jerusalem, is really quite beautiful, because it actually says in Acts 4, there were no needy among them. There were no needy among them. Because for just a moment, in the history of the church looked at itself and said, we are a family. And there's no way that one family member is going to amass tremendous wealth while another family member starves. That's not a family. None of us would do that to our own families. And for a brief window of time in the history of the church, we understood that we were a family. And we were embodying. I mean, Jesus and his ministry. So you go from Levitical law to the fulfilling of the law in Jesus Christ. And Jesus and his ministry, they had a common purse. The 12 operated on one budget. And there's reason to believe that they were not totally broke. They had some money. I don't know where they got it from. They were financed by some women, and people probably donated to them. I mean, their one take, you remember on the feeding of the 5,000, when he's like, well, tell me what you have, or he said, why don't you feed them? Remember, they're all hungry. There's 5,000 people. They're all hungry. He's like, they're like, Jesus, send them away so they can go get some lunch. He said, you feed them. And remember what they say? Do you remember what they say to him? They said, that would take a half a year's wage to pay to feed all these people. And you could make the argument that they have that amount of money. That they're basically saying, are you serious? You want us to use up that much of our treasury for lunch for 5,000 people? And he said, okay, fine. Well, what else do you have then? So he's saying, it's possible that he's saying, yeah, let's not spend that much money. But what do we have? Well, we have 5 loaves, 2 fish. Okay, that's good. Let's use that. I'll do a miracle, whatever. So they had money, and they shared the money. People didn't have personal property. They shared it together. And then fast forward to the birth of the church, which is the body of Christ, the expression of Jesus, same thing. They had all things in common, Acts 4 says. And there were no needy among them. Well, some of you have probably heard me do this before, but it needs to be done. The big divide in the world today is not east-west. It's not ideological. It is north-south. It's geographical. So if we take the kind of northern... what's the population dynamics here? You're talking about 350 million, let's just say 300 million people. I just, my kingdom for a dry erase marker that works. 300 million, let's say 300 million people in the U.S. I know it's a little bit more than that. We'll say 400 million people in Europe, say 300 million people in Eastern Europe. So we're talking about a billion people. Okay, that's the northern, I'm going to call it the northern hemisphere. North-south is really the primary divide, the economic divide in kind of global economics. So we're talking about 1 billion people. Anybody know what the total population of the world is? 7. It's about 7. It's probably now it's probably like 7.2 or 7.4. But 1 billion out of 7. So that leaves... it's going to be 750 million in Central and South America. This is probably 1.1 billion in Africa. Let's see. South Asia is probably a billion. 1.1 probably. China and so on is probably... it's probably 1.5, 1.7, something like that. So you're talking about... 4 billion people, or no, this is the remaining. I must have done this wrong. What am I, 6 billion? About 6 billion. So let's just think about this for a second. You're talking about the global south is the majority of the world's population, and the global south is also the residence of much of the developing world. This is where the poverty is, this is where the wealth is. So this is what, 15% of the population of planet Earth? But this population, in fact, we'll just go ahead and make it a cool 20%, which isn't true of the population, but we'll include some of the people in the global south who are wealthy. The top 20% of the world consumes 76.6% of all of its resources, fossil fuels, production, that's what they do, wealth. The world's wealth, I think the total world's wealth is 48 trillion, something like that. And the top 15% of the world holds 36 trillion of that total amount. So I'm not exaggerating. This is this small percentage of the world's population. In fact, the U.S. alone, which is what, 4% of the world's population, consumes 50% of its fossil fuels, something like that. We just take everything. So the average poor person will use 20 liters of water per day, because if you have to go get water, most people on planet Earth have to walk a kilometer or more to get water every day. To go get water, it's not pumped into their house. So they'll use about 20 liters a day. Most of the global north, like in Europe, I want to say they do 150 liters of water a day. You know how much water a day the average American uses? I think it's 600 liters per person. This is clean water usage. So how do you, you know, how do you get by on this? This is all you have to use. By the way, there's all kinds of like waterborne problems. I want to say something like 3/4 of the developing world population is currently suffering from some kind of illness related to water. 3/4 of the population of the global south is suffering with some kind of ailment related to contaminated water. As something as simple as just turning on a spigot for us makes massive difference. 1.8 million children will die this year. 1.8 million children will die this year from diarrhea. Diarrhea. Diarrhea because they drink contaminated water, bad water, which creates like diarrhea, which they cannot stop. They dehydrate, they die. Million. I mean, I'd never want to minimize violence or anything like that, but 50 people get killed in a mass shooting and the world erupts. Love Paris, care for this city. Oh my gosh, pray. It's the world. Can you believe it? And 1.8 million children will die this year from diarrhea because they can't get clean water. That's a crime. And again, we have to understand that it's not because there isn't abundance. There is abundance. We have plenty of resources. We just don't have the will to do anything about it. I think there's some estimate that it would take about $10 billion a year to provide clean drinking water for the world's population. It's a lot of money. $10 billion is a lot of money. To provide clean drinking water for the world's population. But just let's just put that in perspective. That's about the same amount of money that we spend every year in the US on cosmetics. So just to put that in perspective, that's about the same amount of money we spend every year on that is spent every year on ice cream in Europe. Ice cream. It's about the same amount of money that's spent on perfume. That's almost half of what we spend on pet food in Europe and the United States, pet food. I could go on. I mean, we could eradicate poverty in all of its form. We could provide healthcare for every person in the world. We could provide education for every child. We could provide school for every child. We could provide clean water. And we could provide basic food for every human being in the planet if we levied a tariff, a tax of 4% on the top 225 people in the world, richest people in the world. That's all we would have to do. So we're not even saying like be Robin Hood and take all their money. 4% of, if we levied a 4% tax on those people, we could cover all of those problems. So the issue is not that the money isn't there. The issue is that the will is not there to do it. A basic education for all could be paid for by $6 billion. Water and sanitation for all people in the world would be about $9 billion a year. Basic health and nutrition for all people on the planet would be about $13 billion a year. Which is not, it's just nothing in the way we spend money. But we don't have the will to do it. We don't have a connection to those problems and certainly not to those people. I said this before, but the battle against poverty is being lost, not won. Because the gap between the poorest 1/5 of the world's people and the richest 1/5 has tripled in this century. In 1976, the wealthiest 1% of Americans owned 19%. So this is true in the U.S. The income disparity is growing in the U.S., just as it's growing between the developing world and the undeveloped world, between the global north and the global south. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger because more wealth is being produced and less of it is getting down to the poor. In 1976, the wealthiest 1% of Americans owned 19% of all private material wealth in the U.S. Today, that 1% owns 40% of all wealth in the U.S. So it's just a massive chasm that's continuing to grow. In fact, that 1%, their share of total wealth in the U.S. now exceeds the wealth owned by the bottom 92% of the U.S. population. So this is the definition. I know these statistics are just washing over you, but they're all important. We're talking 1%, the top 1% of the U.S. wealthy own more than the bottom 92%. And we have a middle class, for God's sake. Can you understand what this means for the rest of the world? We feel like we are a middle class country. Look at that. Everybody's basically makes the same. That's how we roll. That's what we think. And the difference between our way of life, our standard of living, and the rest of the world's is massive. Oh, my favorite. So because the U.S. is the largest economy in the world, because we're less than 5% of the world's population, and yeah, we consume all these fossil fuels, a third of the world's paper, but we create 50% of the world's solid waste. We're less than 5% of the population, but we poop 50% of the, well, all our waste, really, but we... $1.5 billion people worldwide do not have access to safe drinking water. So, a simple thing like a filter or a healthy well, it's just not. I mean, where we were recently in Haiti, there were two pumps, like on both sides of the slum, and my guys didn't know, we never talked about it, but didn't realize just how good that is, how good they had it, because they could actually walk to a water source. And even in most parts of the world, that's hard to come by. An actual well. Sometimes you have to walk miles to get a bucket of water. And that water may or may not be pure. But you take what you can get because you'll die without water. You have to have water to do everything, really. Seven billion people on planet Earth. And yet the top 225 people... Just 200 people in the world hold, it is equivalent to the bottom 50% all their wealth. So that's 3.5 billion people. That's disparity, isn't it? These guys have the same amount as these. So I'm God, let's say, and I'm in heaven and I look down on my children, my family. And I say, I've given you enough fossil fuels. I've given you enough grain. I've given you enough rainfall. I've given you enough springs. I've given all this to you. Look at what you have done. Look at what you've done. This is what you've done. And guys, I'm just going to say something on a personal level. We deify these people. We think they're heroes. We treat them like they're heroes. We read the books they write. We want to know their advice on life and everything. We think people that can make this kind of wealth are somehow special. They're not. This is a problem. This is evil. I mean, I don't know. I don't even know how to deal with that. How to address that in our hearts. Because the truth is, if I marched a billionaire in here, maybe not in this particular class, but that might be a setup. But if I march a billionaire in here in a different class, you'd listen. You'd lean in. We would pay respect to that. Because our Christianity does not go as deep as we think it does. And our belief that we are Bible following people is partially a delusion. And I don't mean to pick on anybody, and I have my own hypocrisy, I'm sure. But I don't understand Christians' fascination with Steve Jobs. I don't understand. What about that man is worth deifying or emulating? He had no healthy relationships. He was mean, controlling. He was very rich, I understand that. I'm sure he gave away a good portion of his money, but he also died swimming in money. Why is this for us? I'm just saying our own hearts. When Jesus is our example, our leader, our hero, why? Why do we read his biography? Why do we go to the movie? Why do we care? Why do we think he's some sort of icon for creativity and innovation? By the way, I just finished reading, just to lighten the mood for a second, I just finished reading Richard Branson's book, The Virgin Way, which is, Richard Branson is the CEO of Virgin Records, Virgin Airlines, all his very many, he's sort of a crazy person, and he loves to do April Fool's jokes. He loves these elaborate April Fool's pranks. And so I think it was like 1984, Richard Branson did this elaborate, because he was Virgin Records, and so they did this elaborate prank where they announced to the world, like this big press release, that they had created a box that had all the music ever created in it, and you could access it by computer, any song in the world through this box. But it was a joke. Of course, nothing like that existed. No one ever thought of it. But to him, it was funny and it was a joke. And he thought of that. And supposedly, according to him, Steve Jobs saw that, thought that was a very fascinating idea, and later told Richard Branson that gave him the idea for the iPod. Richard Branson's joke was Steve Jobs' big, one of his big ideas. So he doesn't deserve that much credit anyway. That's all I'm saying. came from a jester, the court jester. This more I could say about this. I mean, I think this is, there's a lot to discover in this dynamic. I think too, if you love God and you want to really know his heart, and you want to do theology in a way that is open and true, I think you have to make some trips into the global south. I think you have to physically move your body out of the global north and this sort of Kool-Aid we drink here. And not just go on vacation or something, but to really ask questions, to be mentored by people in the global south about God, about what's real. And yes, things like economics. What is it like for you here? How do you feel about NAFTA? Or how do you feel about our trade policies? Or how do you feel about the U.S. in general? Or this sort of axis of power here. By the way, this is shrinking. I just read a statistic today that now 40% of the former Soviet Union lives in poverty. So even this is sort of changing. It's condensing, you know, the wealth is really condensed. It continues to condense. How will we stand before God who's given us an abundance and who knows and sees all things? How can we believe in a good and just God who would ignore this global theft and misuse of power? I mean, in our own recent history, when someone murders another person without just cause, their blood cries out for justice. But what about these crimes? Is there no cry for justice? Did the blood of these children who die from preventable causes because we're greedy? Because we're insensitive? Because we lack compassion? Because we lack perspective? Because we feel entitled? What about that kind of crime? If we hold back the medicine, do we not commit murder? I mean, don't get me started on pharmaceuticals. Billions of dollars are invested in discovering cures and treatments for diseases, and then that is monetized. And I understand, in one sense, it has to be, because this is how free markets work. It costs billions of dollars in research. You have to recoup those billions. So now you have, I mean, think of the ethical dilemma here. Now you've created a cure for something that millions of people suffer from, but you can't just give it to them. You have to charge them in order to recoup your monies. I mean, I feel like every pharmaceutical company, by law, should be a nonprofit. Because any excess money is going into the pockets or the coffers of investors or CEOs or whatever. That's lives that are lost. So whatever monies you have to recoup in order to pay for the research and development, okay, fine. But then any excesses, anybody who's getting rich off of pharmaceuticals, that's people that aren't getting that medicines because they're poor. And their lives could be saved because the production costs are small. It's not like you're going into the jungle like Willy Wonka and getting the little bean or whatever he got, the little juice that he had to get, and there's only a little bit and it saves all, you know, for the world, and that's why it's a rare commodity. No, it's all proprietary capital. It's like, we know how to do this, we figured it out, we can sell it at any price we want. Liberation theologians see this kind of global system and this global systemic exclusion of the poor as part of what God and what Jesus and what the Bible will judge, is judging. And part of the work of the church is standing with these people, standing with the people of God to see a couple things, three things. One, that we are not a part of it. We have to find a way to step out of this system. We don't want to be too enmeshed. Because I think it will be judged. And we don't want our lives to be too intertwined in it. We need to not be part of it. That's the first thing. The second thing is that we find a way to oppose it, to actively oppose it. I mean, practically, specifically, intentionally opposing a system that devalues the very poor and only values the extremely rich. And then third, that we actually try to set up systems with alternative principles. I think we're supposed to be a glimpse of a redeemed system. I still think that what God was trying to establish in Leviticus 25 and what he was trying to establish in that little band of followers with Jesus and what he was trying to establish in the first church, I don't think God has given up on that. I don't think God is like, well, I tried. People, you know, they just won't. I really don't think God is that impatient. I don't think he's that weak-willed. I think that he's just as committed as he was then, as he was in Israel's history, as he was in the first century. I think he's just as committed to the idea of economic justice today, and I still think it's something that he wants to implant into the heart of his church and his people. I just think we tend to be a product of our environment more than we want to admit. We tend to be a product of our culture more than we want to admit. And our culture is very, very wrong when it comes to this kind of thing. When it comes to money and economics, we are wrong. We are wrong. And every culture has blind spots. Every culture has sin it cannot see. And this is ours. This is our, well, we have others, but this is our favorite. We cannot see that the love of money is the root of all evil. We cannot see that. We do not believe that. We don't read that verse. We don't talk about that verse. We don't repeat that verse. We don't understand it. It's not in our Bible. We love money. And we love people that get money. And we love the stories of people telling us of how they got money. And we love the idea of people having a lot of money. And we don't connect the fact that when that person has a lot of money and that person has no money, that there's a relationship there. We think that's okay. And I don't see that in Scripture. I don't see where God is ever saying that kind of disparity is fine. In fact, when you really hear the voice of the prophets, it's actually the opposite, that God is furious with the way that we hoard wealth, whether we don't pay a fair wage, the way that we refuse to operate with the ethics of equality and equal distribution. And by the way, the problem with just saying to the ultra-rich, just be generous, just give, because I mean, I look at someone like Bill Gates. In the 90s, when I would teach on this subject, I would always just put down Bill Gates. Because Bill Gates, you could just put him right here. And he's a person we all knew. We could just sort of like trash him. I would always trash him. And then something happened to him. Maybe he heard me or something, or maybe he heard everyone. And this dude is probably the biggest philanthropist in the world now. I mean, I don't know of anyone who gives away more money than he does. In fact, he quit his work really and has become, his whole life now is trying to figure out how to give away his money. And he's doing some really, really cool stuff with like seed manipulation and trying to find like drought resistant seeds and stuff like that to give to poor nations so that they never have to suffer famine. It's really, really interesting research he's doing. But the problem with still saying it's great that you became uber rich, and now the uber rich are going to be generous and they're going to give away all their money, is it still creates this idea of dependency and disempowerment. It's still like Bill Gates is a hero and these poor people need to be saved by him. Where from the end, we saw it more like Jubilee. We saw it more like, well, this isn't my money to begin with. You know, it's like if he just gave it to his employees all over the world. They just earned more, and he just earned less. And he earned $100,000 a year, like a normal person. That's not a normal person. Pretty good. I'm just saying, I'm willing to give him $100,000. I mean, let's have a vote or whatever, but I'm cool with it. Like, he can have extra. And he just took less. I think of a guy like Dennis Bakke. Did I already talk to you about Dennis Bakke? Dennis Bakke's, well, of course, I know his brother, Ray, who is sort of a leading urban theologian. In fact, now there's the Bakke School of Theology, I think, which is in Seattle, and he's done all this thinking on kind of this stuff, global economic justice and urban theology and so on. But his brother, Dennis, that's Ray. Ray is the theologian. His brother Dennis is the businessman. He actually owns power plants all over the world. He's filthy rich. Their company, I guess, their enterprise around the world is amazingly wealthy. But he's a Christian, Dennis Bakke. And so he created the Mustard Seed Foundation, which is one of the most generous foundations, Christian foundations in the U.S. And he takes all of that wealth. First of all, when a power plant is, let's say he has a power plant in Ecuador, he has this like radical profit sharing model in his power plant. So if the power plant makes more money, first of all, what they're doing is good. It's providing power to areas and countries which need more power. So he's doing that. Second of all, he creates this model, this sort of Leviticus 25 model in his power plants, where if they create more wealth, it gets distributed to all the workers. So if you're on the line, or you're just a repairman, or you do some menial job, and the power plant makes more money that month or that year, you earn more. Everybody benefits from the growth of the company. And then what he's done at the very, very top of the company is he has a group of Christians who are his sort of advisory board, and they set a salary for him. And he wants his salary, I forget what it was, last I heard it was $150,000 or something like that. This is a guy who could be a billionaire, you understand. And so he wants this group of people to set his salary at what he thinks is like a fair wage for his position, not more, not less. And so he lives very humbly. And all the rest of the wealth that it creates, he's turned into this Mustard Seed Foundation and gives the money away. That's an alternative system. And I ask you, I mean, I want you to think about him for a second. Do you think he's happy with his life? Do you think Bill Gates is happier than him? More fulfilled? I don't. I think that at the end of the day, he has enough, more than enough. And this is the apostle's heart. Our desire is not that you'd be hard pressed. I'm not asking you to give so that you can be broke, but so that there can be equality. That's really the goal. There's more I could say, but I'm going to stop. Last thing. When Jubilee begins, a trumpet is blown. And the law required that the day the Jubilee began, the trumpet that's blown on that day is also the same day as the Day of Atonement. And every year they would have the Day of Atonement, where the goat is sacrificed, the scapegoat, the sins of the people are placed on this animal. And the people recognize they need to be forgiven. They're sinful. And atonement needs to be declared over the people through the sacrifice, the blood sacrifice, through the death of an animal. And isn't it interesting that Jubilee was meant to be ushered in on the same day as the Day of Atonement? Because there's always been a connection between our sins, our personal sins, and our structural sins. And the releasing of the slaves and the forgiveness of debts and all of those things are connected to our own atonement. This is part of, I think, what Jesus died for. He died to save sinners and sinners' systems. He wants to atone not just us, but he wants to atone for our broken relationships and our wickedness, our greed, our selfishness towards each other. And the cross does that. It does that. So even though there's guilt here in me and you, there is not condemnation because of Christ Jesus. And I'm thankful for that. But it doesn't mean that we don't face these sins. It just means that we're not condemned by them. But we need to see them judged, either in this life, in our practice, or they will be judged in the world to come. Any questions or comments? or clarifications on any of this? It's I know it's meandering, and I know it's covering a lot of ground, so. And actually, it's interesting because one of our values in the underground is simplicity. You probably saw that. And it's funny because there's a certain kind of person that likes simplicity because they're minimalist or something, or it's aesthetic. And I kind of see that a little bit, that there's that simplicity is a fad, or it was a fad. It's actually going out. And so for a while there, people sort of agreed with, yeah, simplicity, awesome, you know. I just have my one pair of pants or whatever. I'm simple. But the simplicity is not something in their heart that's rooted in economic justice. It's not because we're trying to be different in the world, or we're trying to say, not us, we cannot participate in this kind of abusive system. So our simplicity, I think, has to be rooted in the desire for economic justice. And we have to be aware of the fact that our greed and our unwillingness to say no to our own desires is having a negative effect on the rest of the world and on people whom God loves. And we have to see that connection. So while I do think there is a beauty to simplicity and there's an aesthetic to a simple life, where you don't have a lot of clutter and you don't just have a lot of the acquisition of a bunch of crap or wealth, or, you know, we want deaccumulate to have like the tidying up? What's that woman, the greatness of tidying up or something like that? Yes, Maria Kondo. I read it. It's not just that. It's that we believe in justice, economic justice. That's why we live simple lives. Some of us might like simplicity. Some of us might like having loads of stuff. But we both agree to live simple lives for the sake of the poor and the needy. I don't need another tablet. I don't need a better car. I don't need new furniture. I don't need that new appliance if my refrigerator still works. I don't need that, and so I make the choice not to buy it. And I actually see, I've seen people who are simple, who like the idea of simplicity, buy things that seem simpler. Like a bike with only one gear, because that somehow seems simpler than the 12-speed they had, when real simplicity is keep the 12-speed. You understand? Keep the same. You have a bike. You don't need another bike because it's one color and it has one gear. And it's cool to be simple, and that feels simpler. Keep the bike you have. That's, to me, simplicity is nerdy. It's not cool. And if you don't feel a little dorky sometimes, you're probably not living a simple enough life. So a simple person rides that girl's bike that's in the backyard, even though you're a man. Because it has two tires and it works, and it's fine. But a simple person rides that bike with the fat seat and the whole thing. That's simplicity. Not, oh, I'm going to go get a cool, simple bike. You know, that's not. I'm not sure why I'm talking about bicycles, but. Yeah, filet.
So I'm trying to understand or wrap my mind around the whole, I get for doing that there could be a massive generational impact on multi-generational wealth. I'm still trying to understand, like, how. Is it wrong, or isn't there something to be said? I thought it was in progress that it's like you leave a legacy.
No, I think you're right, and I'm probably misspeaking when I say you get nothing, because the truth is, if all the land goes back to the families, well, you get land, and you get livestock, and you get wealth, and you get that river that runs through your property, and you get all the things that we had when we started, that's all. It's not that you get nothing. It's that you get what everyone else gets. You get equality. So they would have inherited wealth. What's interesting is that if, as a father, I was a complete loser and lost a bunch of my land, my son, in a sense, would still get that land. Like, God still gives him an inheritance of the land, even though I mismanaged mine. And if I was great and like took over a whole bunch of extra land, still my son only gets the equal proportion of land. So whether your father was great, a great man and a great entrepreneur, or a loser, in God's system, both sons start with an inheritance, and daughters. So you're right, and you're right to say that. It's not that they get zero. They are given a good inheritance to begin with. It's just not way more than others because I did better. So now my kids have an advantage over the other kids, you know. Yeah. Savings and retirement and stuff like that, yeah. Look, if you asked me that question as a friend, I'm going to answer it one way. If you ask me that question as a theologian, I'm going to answer it a different way. So, this is what Jesus said. Do not store up treasures in barns. In fact, don't store up treasure on this earth at all, where moth and rust decay. Instead, store up treasures for yourself in heaven, where moth and rust cannot decay. So, in a sense, is Jesus saying it's not important to have security? It's not important to have a retirement. It's not important to have savings. No, he's just saying, don't save it here. He's saying you ought to have savings, and you ought to have security, and you ought to worry about your retirement, and you ought to worry about the life which is to come. But he's saying, look, guys, there's two places to store wealth. And you think the best place to store wealth, which will give you security in this life, is in your barns here, in your savings account here, and your IRA here. And I'm telling you, there is another place to store wealth. And that place will give you a security beyond anything that you can imagine in this life and in the life to come. Because Jesus said in that same discourse, he said to his disciples, anyone who gives up homes, land, brothers, mothers, relationships, resources, anything for me and my name will get in this life 100-fold, both now and in the life to come. And some of you have heard me to teach on this before, but that has been my experience. My experience has been that by not having, and I'm not proposing that you not have savings. That's your conscience. But me, by not having big security measures in my own life, instead, what I have is 100 homes in this city and around the world. Because what I've amassed in this world is people, relationships, love, friendship, that I could, maybe not forever, but I could probably crash on all your couches for a little while. I think you would probably let me do that. And you, me. Me, you. You, me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You, mine. Yeah. And I think that's what Jesus means. I think he means if you give up something for my sake, he's saying that what you get is this family. So yeah, you give up your own sort of, I'm going to handle my own future and take care of my own security. But what I will give you instead is this family, this community. And I have family all over the world. My people are everywhere. And if you'll join this family, then in this life, you'll get 100-fold whatever you gave up. If you gave up a house, there's 1,000 houses you'll gain in this life. I mean, I don't think I would ever have to be homeless, ever. Even if I was totally broke and even a little mentally crazy or something. I think there's so many of you that would take me in. I'm sure of it. And if that isn't true, don't break my delusion. Let me keep believing that's true. But I don't know if that's exactly what Jesus means when he says store up treasure in heaven, but I feel that way. I feel that I have stored wealth somewhere else that people can't see, where moth and rust do not decay. And I feel like a rich man. I do. Like in every way, I feel like a rich man. I drive a car that works. I live in a house that mostly doesn't leak. I feel like a rich man. I'm surrounded by people who love me, who would fight for me, who would give me their last dollar or a share their burrito bowl. So should we care about retirement and should we save money? Yeah, I just think if we put our security somewhere else, those things would change. The way we feel about them would change. Their significance would change. I mean, look, I have $20 in my wallet right now. I have $20 cash in my wallet. That's saving, isn't it? I'm not spending it right now. Oh my God, I can't keep it because it's money. I'm not supposed to save in barns, you know? This is a little barn in my pocket. I mean, we all save money. I mean, you get your paycheck and you don't rush out and spend it all or give it all away. We all save money. The nature of using currency in this life is saving. You save it, if only for a week or only for a month or a couple months. There's nothing wrong with saving. The problem is putting our security in that, saying these barns will save us. And in the end, Jesus said, no, a storm will come, the barns will be washed away, and your life will be required of you. You will be judged. Because we said, oh, eat, drink, be merry, for tomorrow we die. And actually, you're going to be judged. And you're not going to be ready because all this stuff you thought was important, and you invested all this time and energy and wealth in, while the poor went hungry, your life will be required of you. That's what he says. So part of it is us, like, and this is a whole different lecture, and it's probably online, you can look it up, but to me there's a connection between poverty and idolatry. Poverty exists in the global south because idolatry exists in the global north. And I think there's a religious connection too, that our economics is related to our idols. Like, we make sacrifices to our idols. We pay tribute to our idols. Our idols of security and safety. Our idols of I mean, insurance for that matter. I mean, we basically created an industry called insurance. I mean, think about it. It's an amazing thing. Like, we just said, what if something bad happened to me? Can I pay money so that I don't have to worry about something bad happening? You know, you can insure, Lloyd's of London will insure anything. We can insure his hair, because it's so beautiful and amazing. And what if something happened to his hair and we just have to insure it? So if he starts losing it, he gets a payout. Because maybe he makes all his living off of his hair, and that's his greatest thing. You can insure your knee, you can insure your voice, you can insure your eyes, you can insure your anything you want, you can insure them. Because what if something happened to them? You know, sports people do that like athletes will insure their knees or insure their Achilles heel or whatever, so that we don't have to face uncertainty or whatever it is in the future. We will pay money, invest tons of wealth in that industry just in case. Just in case. Yeah.
Do you know any practical resource, like in thinking of setting up alternative systems, of things like even thinking about where to bank or any kind of, I mean, think back to 5 years ago in Urban Theology, I remember you mentioned, when you both think about who's willing to forgive third world debt. So I've spent a tiny bit of time trying to figure out who cares about that. I cannot find it, and I don't, and I really care about all of this, but just there's 24 hours in a day, and so if there's any practical resource that suggests certain things that are already out there, or someone else's research.
Yeah, I mean, yes, there's loads of suggestions. There's all kinds of Christian co-ops, and there's alternatives to insurance, medical. There's loads of these things exist, and if you felt moved to do those things, you could. I mean, I might point you to Sojourners as a resource. This is what that magazine is always trying to kind of talk about. If you've not read Ron Sider, you should probably get into him. Maybe a millennial that's talking about this would be like a Shane Claiborne. And all those people are going to have practical suggestions. And actually, someone like a Shane Claiborne is trying really hard himself personally to embody some of these choices and to live in a certain way. For me, it's a heart thing, and I'm wary of a new kind of Phariseeism or a new kind of legalism or self-righteousness which can creep in these matters. So just beware of that. I think if we try to live a different way, it will look ordinary. I think it's possible for us to kind of make choices about our money which aren't loud and aren't necessarily grandiose, but are just quietly different. That's just my personal, yeah.
With respect to what you said, where does step three, this idea of alternate systems, which suggests groups of people working together, come into play?
Yeah. I think the underground is an example of an alternate system. I think all of our microchurches should be alternate systems. For example, I can say to you what Acts 4 says, there should be no needy among you. So the first thing you can do is treat everyone in your ecclesial sphere as family. And that to me is radical. So Julie, going back to the thing do I want to join some sort of hippie commune or co-op or something? No, I'm not as interested in that. But what I'm interested in is the 50 people in my personal life network, can there not be a single needy person among us? And then can we also welcome in the stranger and some needy people and take those people's needs upon ourselves? And there just keeps being a pressing towards equality. And can we all decide to just take... See, I'm in a very interesting position, which many of you will never be in, which is I get to set my salary at whatever I want. I mean, within reason. But my board of directors would like me to make $70,000, something like that. That's I can make that within our salary scale, with the number of dependents I have, because I have 8 dependents, and I could make up to whatever that amount is, and they would like me to. So my board of directors doesn't love it that I only make $30,000 a year. They don't like that. But what I say back to them, of course, I can set my salary anywhere in that range that I feel I need to. So that's an interesting place to be, isn't it? To kind of be like, you could take up to $70,000. How much do you want? What would you take? Would you take less if you didn't need it? And you'd be like, well, I'll find the need for it. I mean, if I need it, I'll figure out a way to need it, you know? But the truth is, because I feel so connected to you, and because I feel so connected to what we do, and because I see how much my staff make, which is less than me, many of them make less than me, I just don't want to take more. I'd rather give more to them or give the money away to a project I see, or I'd rather hire someone else because I think, oh man, there's all this other stuff I want to do for the underground and for our people and for the kingdom. So I'm just like, oh, if I could take $12,000 off my salary and I could convince someone to work for $1,000 a month, which I do, then that's a whole nother person that could be working in the kingdom for all these amazing microchurches and all these amazing leaders. So I just don't want it. I mean, it's not like I wouldn't like to have some more money, but the truth is I don't need it. So I figure out what do I need, and that's the amount I take. That, I think, is radical. And if you work a job and they say, well, we'll give you $150,000 a year, you can be like, well, that's awesome, thank you. I don't think you should give it back. Because I don't know that that's necessarily going to go toward economic justice. You know, so you still have stewardship of that 150, but you still want to ask yourself the question, how much do I need? How much does my family need? And once you answer that question, it's not that God wants my kids to be broke or poor. He doesn't. Poverty is evil. He doesn't want us to be poor. He doesn't want them to be poor. So once I get to the point where, like, my kids are good, my family is good, we have all that we need, then, okay, then I'm done. I'm good. I'm set. The rest of it is for something else. Do you see what I'm saying? Now we can fund something, or we can pay for something else, or we can invest in another thing, or I just think that's the way we should think. Take what you need from the pool, and not more, never more. The cool thing about my world, my job, is that it feels like this is God's money. I mean, when people give it in the name of God, in the name of Jesus, you know. And those that work for us and that take that money as part of their salary, they know. Everybody has this very sacred sense that, yeah, I only make $1,000 a month or $1,200 a month, but that money is precious because it comes from God's people. And so we must work very, very hard to be worthy of that money. And we feel like it's a lot of money. So I think I have an advantage, but the truth is all that we get from the hand of God. All of that is provided to us comes from the hand of God. And we ought to have the same feeling about it. And I think if the people of God, if the church really understood that and felt that way, wealth would be totally distributed differently. I wonder if that would be enough, you know, the changing of hearts, if that would be enough. Anything else? I know I'm not practical, and that's not my job. I'm teaching liberation theology, so ask somebody else to be practical. I'm terrible at being practical anyway, so. And maybe it's good for you to just wrestle, and it gives you a chance to, like, have good conversations on your own. What does it mean? How do we live that out? I think that's meaningful. Yeah. One more class. I'm gonna open up about what I think and pros and cons and whatever. So that should be an interesting class. And of course, if there's any lingering questions that you have, you know, bring them, and we'll try to have like a spirited debate and discussion next week about the flaws, shortcomings, whatever. Some of the stuff. And I will give a little bit of a prescription for what I think is kind of a model for life in the light of these realities. Okay?
Sounds good.
Thanks, guys.